So I wanted to finish the gravity part, so it was a bit fast. So I will treat the multiple expansion of the electromagnetic case, which is technically simpler. It has the same problems as the gravity one. There is a gauge transformation. There is more multiples than what you want. And at the end, you have two sets of multiple moments. So let me explain this from scratch. So the multiple expansion of Maxwell equation with sources in, so we are like gravity. We impose a transversality condition, the Lorentz condition for electromagnetism equals zero. Then Maxwell equation becomes this, minus 4 pi over C g mu. Okay? The only difference, so for Einstein's, this A becomes h bar mu nu, which was there before my kind assistant erased everything. And the source had two indices, T mu nu, okay? And let's remember also something which is true in both cases. There is a compatibility condition. Evidently, if you impose this condition and with this thing, it's because the source was conserved, because if I now take the divergence of the left-hand side, it has to be zero, but we know it was zero. So before I did anything, because of the structure of Maxwell equations that had the structure d nu f mu nu equal, now I don't know the sign for sure, at this thing, there is a Bianchi identity which says that if I take d mu of this, the source had to be zero, okay, which is well known. And it's also true for Einstein's equation, except it's the contracted Bianchi Einstein contracted Bianchi identity for the Einstein case. Okay. Now, what I said is that if you decompose the source J mu, let's say, contravariant in the charge density, with the conventions you need a velocity of light here, and the ordinary spatial current. Similarly, A mu contravariant if you decompose it in a scalar potential and a vector potential. Okay, then, as I said, this thing you can solve by using this general formula. So it gives that the scalar potential phi is a sum with this decorating coefficient, sum over all L from 0 to infinity, of spatial derivative. So I remind you that this is a repeated spatial derivative L times with indices. And then here you have FL of U over R, where U here is T minus R over C. So what we are doing here, let me repeat, is that we have a source, which here is J mu. This source is generating waves, okay? You take a point, a field point here, and you decompose here in this form in terms of symmetric trace-free tensors. This is a symmetric trace-free tensor, which is a retarded wave also, because it's a function of T minus R over R with this derivative. It's a solution of the of this equation outside the source, okay? And AI is 1 over C, the sum of minus L over factorial L, DL of, here you can use the formula above, but you say the index I is like an extra index, 1, 2, 3. But the multipolar decomposition is a decomposition which is symmetric trace-free with respect to these L indices. Okay. And at this stage, the point, the formula that I did not remember this morning, but I have it here now, is to say this object is irreducible. It is a symmetric trace-free tensor, so it's an irreducible representation of the rotation group. Here I have an object which has symmetric trace-free with respect to these L indices, but not with respect to this extra thing. But I can decompose it in three parts, UIL plus, you put just some numerical coefficients. I will comment about numerical coefficients in a moment. The Levi-Civita tensor. Okay, so let me put hats over these objects. Plus 2L minus 1 over 2L plus 1 delta I IL dL minus 1. Let me make the remark I wanted to make. One advantage of working with symmetric trace-free tensors is that everything is rational. When you work with YLMs, all the coefficients have square roots of LL plus 1 and things like that, because the normalization condition makes square roots appear everywhere. Okay? Here it is algebra among tensors with L or L plus 1 indices, and you just have factors that come from the dimension of space, or 2L plus 1 that comes from some dimension of DL spaces. Now, what are these? Here I have written the explicit formula which says that these objects belong to the tensor product of the space of vectors and the space of irreducible tensors with L indices. And this has been decomposed. This is a symmetric trace-free tensor with L plus 1 indices, so this belongs to DL plus 1. Here, there is an object here, which is a symmetric trace-free tensor, which has this notation. Yeah, I did not define L minus 1. Yeah, I said L is a multi-index, so L means I1, I2, IL. L minus 1 is a condensed notation just to say I1, I2, I index L minus 1. It means L minus 1 indices, but as a multi-index, okay? So this thing has L minus 1 indices here and an extra index here, yeah. The notation when indices like IJK are put in these brackets, this means it's a projection to make it symmetric trace-free. So it means first you make it symmetric, then you take away all traces. Remind you that if I have, for instance, a tensor with just two indices, this object means first I make it symmetric, so I take the symmetric part, and then I take away one third of delta ij, the trace TSS. Okay, so it's an example of projecting a tensor which is not symmetric, and we attach some trace onto something which is symmetric without trace. And this, so this object has L indices, is symmetric trace-free, so it belongs to DL. And this object belongs to the representation DL minus 1 because it is symmetric trace-free with only L minus 1. And this is an identity if the objects which are denoted here are the following. This object, symmetric trace-free, is, as I said, I take the object with L plus 1 indices and then I project it to be symmetric trace-free. It's a projection operator, okay? The C, which has only L indices, is obtained by taking my object G, because I decompose this. So this has L plus 1 indices, so I can write it as G, A, B, and then L minus 1 indices that remain. And then I take an epsilon Levi-Civita. Here I have I1 up to IL minus 1, so I can add the IL here. And I mean, it's an extra index, A, B. And then I take the symmetric trace-free projection over these L indices. So this object is symmetric trace-free. And these extra indices are contracted. Okay. So, and the last object is the simplest. The last object, DL, which has L minus 1 indices, is simply obtained by taking this thing and taking a trace. But evidently, I cannot take a trace over these indices because it is trace-free. So the only trace I can take is between one index at the beginning and any index there because it's symmetric anyway. So it means I have L minus 1 indices remaining. Okay, so this is a very trivial thing. This is a trivial thing. This is more subtle. And here you have an identity where epsilon appears twice. It must appear twice because everything is parity invariant in what I'm doing. So if I change the sign of epsilon, this convention changes sign, the other convention sign, and I use the identity that the product of two epsilon is the sum of deltas, okay? So this is just an algebraic identity. which is the translation in the language of tensors of this famous thing that that the representation of a vector of spin 1 times spin L is spin L plus 1, spin L, and spin L minus 1. Okay, just to... But now, so I can plug this here. But now I need to use two different facts. I am in a Lorentz gauge. I can add to mu. I can make a gauge transformation. Here I'm in electromagnetism, so a gauge transformation is a gradient of a scalar, while in gravity it is the gradient of a vector with two symmetric terms. Okay? And now to stay in the Lorentz gauge, if I'm in the Lorentz gauge, it means d mu in mu is zero, but then it means I must have block of xi equals zero. So the most general gauge transformation I can make to stay in the same gauge and to be compatible with this expansion is to say psi, a general solution, will be a sum over L of dL psi L of t minus r over c over r. So I can play. So I have an infinite sequence of symmetric trace-free tensor, which is the multiple decomposition of the gauge transformation. So if I add this term here, I will have a formula which depends on FL, the various, so now I only look at irreducible objects, so symmetric trace-free tensor. So this was by this formula, it's given, and remember this FL there, let me say again, these objects are obtained by the solution of this equation. As I said, this equation is of the same type as the scalar equation, except there is an extra index, which is a numerical index. So I can use these formulas to compute FL and this GIL as a function of the source. Okay, so like for instance, FL will be an integral, will be this integral, integral of d3x of the source for phi, but the source for phi is the density rho, J0, okay, taken in that sense bar, and then XL. So it looks, FL at this stage looks like the multiple moment of the charge density. But this is not the end, because I have these other things which are UL, CL, and the L for any L, they are L plus one indices, okay, but for generic L, they are symmetric trace-free tensors, which are also given by integral, and there is the delta L of Z here, the rho bar means this thing with this integral over delta L, okay. But now I have these objects, which are integrals over the source, and then I have this xi L, which I can do whatever I want to simplify the formula. Okay, and I have something else, which is that the source must be conserved. Okay, and the conservation of the source, which implies this thing, if I apply this formula here, I will get relations between this, because you see, if I take the time derivative of phi and the space derivative of this, I will have multiple expansion of this type. If I replace this, I will have a multiple expansion in irreducible terms. And if you have something in irreducible terms, something must vanish. I mean, each irreducible thing has to vanish. So this condition or this condition gives me relations between the time derivative of FL, because in doing that, I have also an identity, which I can even write from the paper with, yes. Let me write it so it will be clearer. For instance, I get an identity which is the time derivative of the FL is equal to something like integral over x, xl, integral dz, delta l, the z. And then I have minus d by d xi j bar I plus z over c and I d by d, time derivative of j tilde I. Okay? Yes. And then this thing, I can integrate by parts. And then from this, I get a relation between some of these moments here, the ones that appear here. And then one needs to work out all these identities and use Xi so that at the end, you find.
Sorry, but G bar didn't depend on you. It's T and X you have integrated in some sense on U.
Yes. Here the U means T. Yes. Sorry. I've changed papers and things like that. Yes. Yes. It's a variable. I'm trying to give the logic of the thing. So that after a gauge transformation, which you compute, so you compute what you want to add. Okay, you compute the Xi L by using these identities between DFL and the other multiple moments, so that at the end, in a new gauge, you have phi prime of T and X, which is the sum of, so let me write the electromagnetic case, factorial L DL QL of T minus R over C over R, let me write explicitly, and AI prime in this gauge, T and X, is minus 1 over C, the integral over L, sorry, the sum over L minus L over factorial L of, this is a repeated special derivative with only L minus 1 indices. What happens is the time derivative of this symmetric trace free. All these objects are symmetric trace free tensor. I L minus 1, T minus R over C, and plus 1 over 2L plus 1, 2L plus 3. Okay, sorry, I'm reading the wrong line. Where did the thing disappear? Here. It is plus L over L plus 1, epsilon I A B D A L minus 1, sorry, it's not the final formula. Okay. No, it is, sorry. It is. I'd forgotten this notation, of T minus R over C divided by R. So let us look at the result. After a gauge transformation and using the conservation laws linked to the fact that I am in the source is conserved, so modulo this gauge transformation, the general electromagnetic field is expressed in two sets of multiple moments, a QL, a Q for charge, so it's a charge multiple moments. It is the analog of the multiple moments of the charge distribution, but in a relativistic context. And M is for magnetic. It is a magnetic multiple moment. And the explicit expression of these objects are that QL is, what is the good formula here? Do we have a better formula here?
So that means that out of this FUCL, you kill two of them, one by the conservation law,
exactly.
And one by the gauge transformation.
Exactly. The counting is that there were four sets of multiple moments. Because you can count an infinite sequence of multiple moments like a block. One of these infinite sequences is killed by a gauge transformation. And the other one is built by the consequences of this relation, which is scalar. This relation has no indices, so it gives, when I expand it, an infinite set of relations between the derivatives of these four things. And indeed, thank you, Natalie, the counting is that I have four, minus one for a gauge transformation, minus one from the conservation law. Okay, and the same thing in gravity will give four times more gauge transformation and four times more conservation law identities. And then this eliminates from 10 multiple moments, minus four, minus four. It gives at the end two sets of multiple moments. That's why electromagnetism, like gravity, at the end has 2 degrees of freedom. Because another way of saying this is this number of big sequences of multiple moments counts like one scalar field. Because remember, one scalar field is an infinite sequence of multiple moments. So one sequence of STF multiple moments is like one scalar field, one relativistic scalar field. We know that gravity has 2 degrees of freedom, like electromagnetism. That's why at the end, each degree of freedom scalar is like an infinite set of multiple moments. And that's why you expect, by the same counting, that there will be only 2 sets of multiple moments. For electromagnetism, the explicit expression is that there is an integral over x, there is the integral over z between minus 1 and plus 1, and then there is this delta L, the and rho bar in this sense, where,
there is no bar.
What I mean is this thing. So let me put a tilde, where rho tilde means that the time argument is shifted from t to t plus z x over c. You don't shift the space argument, you shift the time. So you introduce z inside, let's say it's an operation. Once you do that, you so z has appeared, then you need to integrate over z. This is a function of z. Okay, so it's the first term. So this term looks like charge density with some fluctuation in the time argument, multiple moments, like a quadruple moment of the charge density. But that's not the full answer, because you have, this is what you were obtaining for FL, actually. The formula for FL is what I wrote. FL is this. But it's not yet the physical multiple moments, because I needed to do this gauge transformation conservation law. So there is an extra term from the transformation. And in that case, you find that the extra term is minus 1 over c squared, 2L plus 1 over L plus 1 to L plus 3. There is the delta, which has now an index L plus 1 as a function of z. And here you have x hat AL d of j tilde. So if the time argument is t, it will be d by dt, the time derivative of the current, which is a vector. So here you have a vector which is contracted. This index is contracted, so it is STF because of this thing. Okay? While here I have a scalar, and it is STF because I have this thing. So this is like an electric type. So it's an electric type multiple moment, STF multiple moments. And you have a magnetic type, which is ML of its argument. Okay, it depends on one variable. It is a very similar formula, simpler for the case of electromagnetism, delta L of Z. And here you have x hat L minus 1 m tilde of I L hat, which where m is the magnetization density, means it is a vector, as a vector, so it's a which is x cos j. You have currents. Okay, we are talking about electromagnetism, so there is a charge density and there is a current density. You take like the magnetic, how is it called, the like Ampere's looping current. Okay, you say it's a small loop which is like a small magnet, magnetic moment. It's the infinitesimal magnetic moment of the current. Okay, it's a magnetization density, which is a vector field inside the source. And this vector field, you take a multiple moment and you just make it symmetric trace-free. So this formula is actually very simple. The only subtlety is that the time argument here is shifted by something. So relativity is here at its stage, okay? The propagation of the velocity of light of the thing is there. So for electromagnetism, at the end, modulo gauge transformation, that's why there is a prime, the full electromagnetic four potential outside the source is expressed as derivative of this moment, or the time derivative of the same moment because of the identity, and the space derivative of this magnetic density. Okay? And these formulas, if you look at Jackson, if you open the book of Jackson, you don't find these formulas, Because everything is done, if you assume that things depend like exponential I omega t, that they are harmonic function of times. And then you use Bessel functions and things like that, so it looks like a bit complicated than Bessel function. Why actually everything is algebraic? And the only subtlety is to have this function here, okay? But hidden there is the transformation which gives a Bessel function.
Where does it come from, this delta L?
It comes
it looks
from
like a sort of smoothing function.
Yeah, it comes. Yeah, let me explain this. It comes. Actually, yeah, it looks mysterious, but it looks like a. Actually, it also looks like a violation of causality in the sense that this is saying. Yeah, let me discuss this. This formula is saying that if I have the source here. And if I compute the field A mu at this point in space-time, this thing does not depend only on the source at retarded time because I am fluctuating by not by t minus r, but by t plus r over c or minus r over c. So I have fluctuations which looks acausal. And the reason is the following. Is that a multiple decomposition is not a local thing. A multiple decomposition says that if I am here, I take a sphere at the same radius r, and then on this sphere, I decompose this field in irreducible thing with respect to rotations on this sphere. And therefore, what I'm doing is I combine the field, you know, all those cuts of the source enter in the definition of the multiple decomposition. This multiple decomposition is non-local here, and therefore it uses an average of the source which has this double Lycone structure. I need to take the source density is here, okay? So I need all those averages. And this thing is this Z, okay? And what happens is that for high values of L, this becomes sharper and sharper, and you are closer and closer to the Lycone. Anyway, this is the answer, okay? And for gravity, I was writing, so for gravity, I will not rewrite the formula that my assistant erased. It had, but the important point is that it had again only two types of multiple moments, mass type instead of electric type, you call it mass type, and spin type, because evidently the analog of magnetism is spin in gravity. And these moments, I will just recall their notations, they were called IL and JL. Actually, the letters J is chosen to evoke spin, so these are the spin moments, and then you look for a letter close to J, and I is better than K, so that's why it is, and it has to be before also, so this is IL.
Yes. Does that mean that there is a combination of those which is associated with one polarization and or one ellipticity and another combination?
No, so now let's go to polarizations, okay. This thing that I should rewrite in gravity, I really need it in gravity, so I will write it in gravity in a corner. Maybe I could write it there. I will not write the full formula with all the coefficients, but just to have the structure. I am not in a gauge. The point I want now to explain is that I am not in a gauge where I see the two polarizations of the gravitational wave. I am in an harmonic gauge, and I have more. I can still do a gauge transformation to project on what LIGO and Virgo can see. And this is what it's the next thing I want to explain. So in the harmonic gauge, H00, okay, I will write only this one, okay, is the sum over L, this is just for fun, and you have this thing, IL T minus R over C over R. So that's the simple thing, plus gauge term. Now H0I, it contains something where I don't write the coefficients. There is dL minus 1 the time derivative of this guy with indices I, L minus 1 at the same argument T minus R divided by R. And then there is a third term, which is epsilon I AB dA L minus 1 JB L minus 1 of T minus R over C over R. So at the level of the zero I component of the metric, I have the time derivative of this mass multiple moment, and I have space derivative of the magnetic spin type multiple moment. And at the level of the metric in space, you have something with L minus 2 derivative. Actually, you peel off. It's a very simple thing. Here, there are L indices, but they are all contracted, and this gives a scalar. Here, I want a vector, so what you do is you peel off one index I, but on the symmetric trace tree thing, and as you want the derivative of a function of T minus R over R, you contract the other derivative. Here, you take away two indices, but you need two time derivatives to compensate. And here, you use over R, and you use the conservation law. Yeah. In doing that, you absolutely need to be in a condition where this is satisfied, because you use this to relate the multiple moments, so which were 10 multiple moments, minus 4, minus 4, which left two multiple moments. So here you have two time derivative of this, and then there is an extra term with coefficients. And then you have the delta, it's not this formula. Then you have d, as you expect, here you have j, and then you have j dot, that is to say, you have epsilon ab, I j dot index j b l minus 2 as a function of t minus r over c over r, and you have these derivatives. So all these objects, let me repeat, all the objects that appear here, they are of the type a certain number of space derivative and then some functions with some indices of t minus r over r. So all the building blocks are retarded waves with some special derivative. They are solution of the D'Alembert equation, free D'Alembert equation. And the objects that come in are irreducible representation of the group of rotations. And you have two types. The same IL appears time differentiated, twice time differentiated. And so this is a mass type moment, multiple moment, and this is a spin type multiple moment. Okay, and the formulas is what I had written before, which was here below, I think. Yeah, it was here, you can still see it. I will write just the first term, like IL of its argument, let's call it U, is an integral over space, or let's call it T. Integral over dz, delta L, xl, and sigma at the shifted argument plus other terms, where sigma was, this is what I had written before, was T00 plus TSS over C square. Okay. So it is a mass type moment, and the other one had the momentum density flux in the source.
But here the gauge is completely fixed, just like in electromagnetism, you have also used.
So here we are in harmonic gauge. And indeed, I have chosen a gauge. Okay. But now to answer the question of Pierre, if I want to, so this expresses, given a source, it expresses the field that it emits, but now I'm interested, I am here, I have some interferometer here, and I want to know, in the sense I explained before, far from the source, it should be a plane wave, okay? First, to answer a question I forgot of Hugo, when I have, so let's look again at this to have this clearly. When, let me do even an example if you, when I have one spatial derivative of something which is f of t minus r over r, just to be clear. What is this? This is minus, if the space derivative acts on this, I get minus ni over r square f of t minus r, okay? But the special derivative can act on the r, which is here. And therefore, I have an extra term, which is minus f dot at the argument of t minus r of the gradient of r itself, which is ni, okay, the unit vector divided by r. So, and if I have more derivatives, I have more time derivatives of f, but I will always have a term in 1 over r. So when I go very far, actually, I will only this term will survive. And therefore, if I go in the wave zone very far, I will have something which looks like a plane wave, which decreases like 1 over r. The coefficient of 1 over r here will be obtained, for instance, by taking the derivative acting only on this guy. Everybody acts on this, here, and here. Everybody should act on this, and then I will have this plane wave. I have part of the thing which is a plane wave, 1 over r. Now, what is observed by a gravitational wave detector? As we said before, to decompose in a different gauge, this thing should be equivalent to an HIJ TT, because we have proven this morning that given a general solution of the linearized Einstein equation very far, there exists a transformation of gauge where I have only spatial components, where 0, 0 is, I want to go in a gauge where H0, 0 is 0, where, or H bar, it's the same thing for this guy, for this thing, where the vector part is 0, and only the spatial part, IJ, is non-zero. And then, but still, I am in a Lorentz gauge, in a harmonic gauge, which means I have the transversality condition that this thing will be 0, okay? And as we have proven this morning, and the trace of H will be 0. So staying within the harmonic gauge, I can now refine the gauge. The problem is the harmonic gauge is absolutely not unique, okay? I can change harmonic gauge a lot, okay? And here I want to change it in order to extract from these formulas what will be observed by LIGO, because this is what you want to compute. The reason why I'm explaining this is that these formulas allow us to compute the multiple moments that are emitted, okay? But now the next question, so this is what you compute analytically, is what do you observe when you have a LIGO-VIRGO? And now I will answer this question. I need to go to this gauge. How do you do that? The way you do that is that first, and that's clear here, if I go very far from the source, I will have a 1 over r wave, but locally this 1 over r wave is like a plane wave. As we know, locally, very far from the source, it looks like a plane wave. And what did we prove for a plane wave? We proved that a plane wave, in general, looks locally something like that. There is a phase factor, and then there is an amplitude. And in the TT gauge, you project everything let me draw something. You have the source. Now the drawing is not in space-time, but in space. So here, it's space. I have the source here. This is emitting waves, okay? These waves are multipolar decomposed, okay? Now I look in some direction here, and I say, locally, these waves here will be plane, because these are spherical waves, but a spherical wave very far from the source looks like a plane. And what we have proven is, and what is the direction of propagation? If I am at a point x here, the direction of propagation is n, actually. It's the unit vector from the source to where I am. This is the wave I'm here, so it's this direction. And therefore, what I need to do is to project on the plane. What we know is that the wave is obtained is only transverse to the direction of propagation. So there is a tensor which is symmetric trace-free in the local plane on this sphere, tangent to this sphere where I am, orthogonal to n. So I take n as a unit vector. I take the two plane orthogonal to n. And then I need to project this wave on this plane in a form which is a symmetric tensor without trace. And this is the answer in the sense that given a direction n, I can define a projection operator, Pij of n, which is delta ij minus ni nj. Okay, this is a projection operator in the sense that if it acts on a vector, so if I take a vector v, okay, Pij vj, the projection of v is what? It is this. It is the projection. V can be projected in along n, okay, and then perpendicular to n. Okay, and what I have written is the part where I have subtracted what is perpendicular. So this thing projects a vector of arbitrary direction in a vector orthogonal to the direction of the wave. Okay, now Hijtt is obtained by doing this projection twice. Because you prove this, that is to say, you go from this gauge to a TT gauge. At the end of the day, you find that if you want to compute what LIGO detects here, okay, or at least what is the wave? The wave comes from some direction, okay? I can take it as something existing in the plane perpendicular to the direction of the wave. Then the LIGO detector is also at an angle, so I will have also cosines of projection on LIGO, but this is a separate calculation. I compute the two polarization of the gravitational waves. But I have a tensor, so what I should do is that I take H in any gauge. For instance, in this gauge, I take it's 1 over R, so I take the 1 over R amplitude of the wave, let's say AKL, T minus R over R. I take this. This is the plane wave from these formulas. And now I want to project it as a tensor in this plane. So what you do is you take this projection operator for the direction n, JL for n. This projects the tensor in the plane. But it has still a trace. So you need to subtract the trace. And therefore, the projection operator is this minus 1 half of Pij of n pkl. You just prove this, okay? I give the final result, okay? This is an explicit algebraic formula which says, given in any gauge, okay, but which satisfy Einstein equation and which is wave-like, I take its special components and then I do these algebraic projections. Okay, where n is the direction from the source to where I am. But this formula allows one to compute explicitly okay, so now I can combine all formulas. That is to say, I take these formulas which express the wave around the source in multiple moments, and then I ask, what do I see here? And then you get really the decomposition of what you see in the LIGO detector as a function of the source, because what I have solved by these formulas is that I can compute the wave emitted to all orders in relativistic. I made no slow motion approximation, okay? The source can be ultra-relativistic. It has to be, I mean, linearized gravity. So the next difficulty will be to go beyond linearized gravity. And we will see how to do that.
But if you take your formula on the right hand side,
yes,
and you pick up only the 1 over R term, which is the first step, and then you project to your gauge TT there,
yes,
then don't you find the standard result of the second derivative of the quadruple moment?
No, but here I have the quadrupole, the octuple, the magnetic wave. At lowest order, we will get this. Yes. Yes, evidently. The idea here is to get the full thing. Yes. Let me first define let me write it this way. In linearized gravity, let me call this operator here. This is a projection operator, okay, which contains four indices, okay? So let me call this thing P with four indices. So P IJKL. Okay, it's an algebraic operation which takes a tensor and projects it in something simpler, which has only components in the plane orthogonal to the direction n that I chose. The formula, which is, so this is the transverse traceless two polarization of the gravitational waves. There is a factor four which comes from just the normalization. There is, okay, so what you do, you take these formulas, and as I said, you keep only the part of the wave which is in 1 over r, okay? So for instance, actually, and only hij, because finally all the other components, they are not important for the projection. They must be related in some way. That's why actually it's the same object that appears here. So immediately I see I will have at least two derivatives of this guy and at least one derivative of this. But as I said, if I take the 1 over r part, I will have L minus 2 more derivatives because I need to act on the argument T minus R. So actually, if I am at a multiple L, I will have L derivatives, okay? Because I have two derivatives plus L minus 2, so 2 plus L minus 2 means that the multiple L will enter with L derivatives. So the quadruple will enter with two derivatives, the octuple with three derivatives, etc., in the waveform, okay? So, but at the end, you find that you have this projection operators, I prime, J prime, IJ. In, I'm changing the notation each time, so let me keep the notation. The unit vector now is just denoted capital N instead of small n, but it's the same as before. It's to distinguish the field point from the source point, okay? And you have a sum over L. Now, when you do the sum, you find that the multiple moments for L equals 0 and 1, they disappear. Why? Because, for instance, the multiple moment for L equals 0 is the total mass of the system, which appears like a Schwarzschild M over R, okay? But it is non-radiative, okay? So this term, when you do the TT expansion, this one disappears, okay? Similarly for the the angular momentum of the source, which is a constant quantity, and the center of mass thing. So the physical degrees of freedom that you record at infinity, they start with the quadrupole, magnetic, or mass type or spin type. Then you have an infinite sum, where also, for the moment, I have kept the velocity of light. Okay, it looks like a nuisance to keep the velocity of light. But actually, what is important, and this is, in a sense, what Einstein already had in mind, is that the multiple expansion is, at the same time, an expansion in powers of 1 over c. If you take higher multiples, they contribute less and less in the sense that they contain more powers of 1 over c. That's what the quadrupole always dominates. It's the leading order term. And then the octupole is a small correction, 1 over c square, formally, compared to the quadrupole, etc. So you get this thing. Then here you have objects that I will denote this way, L minus 2 of, so T minus R, now it's just capital letters, and L minus 2, so minus 2L over c L plus 1, L plus 1 factorial, epsilon AB I V J B L minus 2 and A L minus 2. So B is contracted here. Okay. So the mass multiple moments, I will define what is this object, okay? At this stage, I am defining the following thing. I'm saying that the two polarization of the gravitational waves can be written as an infinite sequence of multiple moments of the TT waves. So these objects are symmetric trace-free tensor, and they parametrize the multiple moments of a general wave, okay? So there are two types of multiple moments, but the work we have done before has expressed these things in terms of IL and JL, which themselves are expressed in terms of the source. So actually, I will be able, like, Einstein did at the lowest level to express what you observe at infinity directly as an integral over the source. But now there's no approximation has been made of the small V over C. Let me, for the mass type moments, because these are mass type moments, the power of 1 over C is L. Why? There is an extra power of 1 over C L plus 1 for the magnetic thing, because always magnetic spin effects in gravity has an extra V over C compared to the thing. So there is less emission. There is always, for instance, the magnetic type quadrupole is less important than the mass type quadrupole. That's why Einstein wrote a formula for a mass type quadrupole. He was fully right. It is the first term. If I write this explicitly, just to see what how it looks, there is, so it goes like 1 over r. Okay? Sorry, I changed the notation several times, but what is small r here becomes capital R. It's just the distance away from the source. Okay? And here I am taking only the coefficient of 1 over r by using these formulas, and I write the formula explicitly. The 4 has become 2 because there is a 1 half here. So I have this projection. Sorry, I prime j prime ij, which depends on the direction from the source. And now let me write explicitly the beginning of this thing. The result of linearized gravity is that these objects, UL, so symmetric transfer with L indices, is finally equal to the Lth time derivative of the mass multiple moments, where this notation means, as a function of one variable, the Lth time derivative. So it's dl over dt to the power L of IL. So it's just a notation. When I have a function of time, because you can write one dot when you have one time derivative, two dots when you have two time derivatives, but when you have L dots, it's not convenient, so you need to know how many time derivatives. So in linearized gravity, this u here is just the Lth time derivative, and I explain why. The reason is, here it appears with two time derivatives. I have L minus 2 space derivative, but they act on this thing here, on the plane wave thing, and therefore it gives finally L derivative of the mass moment. Same thing for the VL as a function of t. In linearized gravity, this is the spin type multiple moments differentiated, again, L times. You can see that it's the same number of time differentiation, okay? Together with the formulas, which gives that IL is some integral over the source. So now I have an explicit formula in linearized gravity, which says if I have a source with some t mu nu in the source. From t mu nu, I compute, it's just a notation, the sum t0, 0 plus tss over c square. Okay, I call it sigma because it comes in naturally. By the way, it is the combination which enters all over cosmology. In cosmology, you have rho plus 3p. Okay? This thing is the energy density plus 3 times the pressure for a thing. Okay? And the fact that in cosmology, in some formulas, this is important, is again important here. For inflation, for instance, it's very important because it changes the sign. It's just saying that Einstein's equation, yes, actually, the reason why this quantity enters is that if you look at R00 from Einstein equations, the source here is T00 plus TSS. Okay, is rho plus 3p, which appears on the right-hand side of Ricci, not of the Einstein tensor, of Ricci. That's why it comes in here. So let me, I was writing explicitly to see what it means. So this term, using this formula, and summing over L, it gives IIJ with two derivatives. So now I have the quadrupole moment with two derivatives. This is the Einstein term, two derivatives of the quadrupole moment, except that evidently Einstein had said that the quadrupole moment is given just by the first term here, the usual quadrupole moment, while here we have a relativistic quadrupole moment with many relativistic corrections. So even if you keep only this term, you have more. The next term is 1 over 3 c, the third derivative of the octuple moment, contracted by the vector n from the source, which enters here, okay, plus 4 over 3c epsilon, I will stop after this term, I, j, j, a, n, b, okay, with two derivatives. So the in the waveform, the quadrupole moment of spin type enters at a coefficient 1 over c smaller than this. That's why Einstein had said that lowest approximation, I have only the quadrupole. But here we see quadrupole, octupole, spin type quadrupole, and then you have infinitely many terms like that. C square, for instance, the next term, which is the four index multiple moment, is something like that. Okay, you just have more and more n vectors, more and more time derivatives, and things like that. Okay, so this is the result of linearized gravity. And then from this result, you can already compute, for instance, what is the energy flux and the angular momentum flux. When you do that, this is where, at this stage, it's not clear why it is useful to have a decomposition in symmetric trace-free objects, okay? The reason is that when you compute the energy flux, for instance, the computation of the energy flux is essentially, will be, why do I put an integral? Yes, no, because, energy flux, I mean all over the sphere, that is to say. What is the total energy flux in gravitational waves emitted from the source, okay? Essentially, this formula is you have an integral over the two sphere, so you have the surface of the two sphere, of hijtt dot, hijtt dot, the square modulo coefficient. You have the wave, which is the two polarization of the waves, and they are like the energy is proportional to the time derivative of h. Why? Because, as we know, for a scalar field, for instance, the t mu nu of a scalar field is d mu phi d nu phi. So in canonical, minus one half of a thing. But it's always time derivative of the field that come in the energy, OK? So similarly here, although I don't want here to enter into the discussion of how you define energy flux in these waves. By the way, in the book which was here this morning of Madame Choquet, this is also discussed. In the high frequency thing, you define the t mu nu of the electron of the gravitational waves as the right hand side of Einstein equations. When you write Einstein equation and you say on the right hand side I put nonlinear terms coming from the gravitational wave itself, they contribute like an additional term to t mu nu, and this gives this. At the time of Einstein, Einstein had computed even before getting general relativity what is the stress tensor, the pseudo stress tensor of gravity. He had conservation law, so he used that, and he had the correct formula, okay? He could not compute the angular momentum, but he could compute the energy flux. Anyway, so imagine now doing this calculation. What do you do? You take this object, you take a time derivative, so immediately, each derivative here will augment by one unit. The quadrupole moment will have three times derivative, this one will have four, and things like that. And now you take this square. And now the fact that these are symmetric, these are irreducible things, means that the cross products all vanish. Because when you have irreducible representations, they are orthogonal with respect to the natural L2 norm that you have. And therefore, when you compute this square, you will have only the square of this, the square of this, the square of this, the square of this, that add linearly, okay? This is the nice thing. So that, for instance, for the energy loss, you will get, I don't know if I have the coefficient here, do I have, but I will write the essence of the thing, like the energy flux, let's say flux in energy, is a sum over L with some numerical coefficients of, if I take these objects, this would be UL with one derivative square plus VL with one derivative, this thing square with some numerical coefficients. And if I replace this formula, UL is the Lth derivative of the Lth type mass multiple moments. This means I have a sum over L starting with 2, where I have the mass multiple moments with L indices differentiated. So let's get it right. L plus 1 times square with some numerical coefficient plus the JL differentiated L plus 1 times square with a numerical coefficient. And the old Einstein quadruple formula. Yes, and indeed now if I keep the 1 over c square, I have, I had 1 over c, so now I get 1 over c square. And actually, if I put everything, I have this 1 over cl, okay? So it means, let me get them. This grows like 1 over c 2l, and this grows like 1 over c 2l plus 2, okay? Yes, modulo an overall factor. So this is saying for each value of L, the magnetic thing, the spin thing, is less important by v square over c square. But it also means that the octupole is 1 over c square smaller than the quadrupole, and the decapole, hexadecapole is 1 over c square even smaller. And this is very important because this is saying that when I have a binary, when I have a source with a characteristic velocity v over c, if v over c is a small parameter, the multiple expansion is also directly an expansion in v over c. I know that if I want to compute things up to v over c 6 or something like that, in the energy flux, I only need to compute up to the fourth moment or whatever, and I can neglect everything of high multiple moments. And this is the way post-Newtonian method can compute things nearly to the end by including more and more things. Although there is the non-perturbative aspect that we will come back to. So now I have talked for 1 hour. So let us stop for a break of 15 minutes, and I will continue with the nonlinear things. So now I will sketch how one, because everything I said was to give some tools, because these tools will be useful for the nonlinear theory, because evidently, we are not interested in linearized gravity. Linearized gravity is never a good approximation in astrophysics, okay? As soon as there is a system with internal gravitational forces, and we are talking about a binary system, so it means the nonlinear effects of gravity are the ones that create the force between the two objects, and therefore, for binary systems, I am never in linearized gravity. So even at the lowest approximation, that's why actually the paper of Einstein with the quadrupole formula cannot be applied to a binary system. It can be applied to an oscillating ball of fluid, something like that, but not to a system which is held together by gravitational forces. You absolutely need to include nonlinear effects of gravity, even for the lowest order quadrupole formula for a binary system. Okay, just and this was realized, first realized by Landau and Lifshitz. In their treatise in 1944, they explicitly say we need to include nonlinear terms. And at the end, when you include nonlinear terms, you recover the same linear-looking quadrupole formula of Einstein. And I want to go beyond that because this is what we need to do to higher approximations. Okay, let me just keep that somewhere. Ah, yes, I will add one formula here, which is just to make the connection with what is done in explicit in LIGO type things, is that when you have for these things, okay, what in practical terms, what people call the multiple expansion of the gravitational waves is measured by some quantities which are called projection along tensor spherical harmonics. Okay, so there is a theory of spherical harmonics which generalizes the scalar spherical harmonics, and I must say it always looks complicated, but the result is very simple to understand, because when you decompose the tensor Hij Tt along tensor spherical harmonics which are labeled by two integers L and M, like the usual spherical harmonics, with M going from minus L to plus L. Okay, I'm just saying what is the relation, because what you find in textbooks and the quantities I have introduced here. The relation is very simple. There is Newton's constant, there is the distance to the, so I'm in the wave zone. There is a square root of 2 for some historical reason, like in the Fermi constant and things like that. It's the only square root which appears. There is a 1 over C L plus 2, okay? Then there is a 16 pi over, okay, this is not important, okay? You just have to know this. And then you have two numerical coefficients that, because now we are in the realm of normalized spherical harmonics whose integral over the sphere of tensorial spherical is 1, you will have square roots for the first time, because each time you have YLMs, you have square root of something. So here you start having square roots. It's just a convention. Before, we did not have square roots. 2 L L minus 1. But what do you have here? You have the UL, which is this UL, okay, which itself does not contain a square root, plus 2i, so UL is mass type, while VL, you see the notation is always to have, the first letter is the more important mass type, and then you go in the alphabet a little bit later, like IJ and UV, to have something that you can understand. And then there is a 1 over C at the level of the amplitude. There is a square root of L plus 2 over 2L, L plus 1, L minus 1, you have VL, and then here, so here these are symmetric trace-free tensors with L indices. Why? This is a complex number, it's a project. So now you project a symmetric trace-free object on a basis, so you compute a number, like the components of something. Because, yeah, maybe let me note this. M goes from minus L to plus L, as we all know, okay? This means M takes 2L plus 1 values, okay? But 2L plus 1 is precisely the dimension of the space we talk about, okay? And therefore, any object which in symmetric trace-free form is a symmetric trace-free tensor with L indices is a member of the irreducible representation of dimension 2L plus 1 of tensors, of Euclidean tensor. And therefore, there exist many bases on which it contains as useful information only 2L plus 1 components, okay? Real components for UL. So you can indeed, there is the same information in UL and something with just LM indices, okay? But now for the waveform, the convention is to compute this in terms of this by having here this, where I had introduced this morning. Remember that the usual YLM, so you take a textbook with YLM, and you say YLM as a function varying on the unit sphere with angles theta phi, I can parameterize it in terms of a unit vector n with n squared equal 1. And actually, as I explained this morning, it is a polynomial in n. And this thing is YLM NL, simply. So it is a polynomial of nth order in the components of NL. The components N, let me remind you, is NX, NY, NZ with NZ cos theta. And here this is sine theta cos phi and sine theta sine phi. Okay? So if I replace this in here, I will have exponential I m phi, okay, the usual thing, and I will have polynomials in sine theta and cosine theta of the Legendre type that I've already explained this morning. Anyway, this defines this thing, and as I explained this morning, this object for a given Lm is a symmetric trace-free tensor for L indices, and the set of these 2L plus 1 tensors is a basis of the set of symmetric trace-free tensors. You use this basis to transform this symmetric trace-free tensor in a number, which is the components in this LM basis. And this number with these coefficients gives you HLM. And this is HLM is what is often plotted in theoretical computation. For instance, the main quadrupole wave is H22. This is even in the most relativistic case. By the way, yes, let me mention this. Here I was saying when the source is moving slowly, the multiple expansion is an expansion in powers of V over C. Okay. What is surprising in a sense is that when you do this decomposition for a coalescing black hole, even near the end, essentially H22 is the most important thing, and the other things are smaller and they become comparable to H22 only really very near the coalescence. And their contribution to the energy flux remains small. So in that sense, this ultra-relativistic thing of the coalescence of two black holes has the good taste of being not too relativistic nearly up to merger. So this type of formula I will use later. But now I want to explain.
What is the connection between this HLM and the formula which connects this HLM to HTT?
Yes, so the good thing is that my assistant did not erase everything. I can answer now. Because everything is on the blackboard. So HTT is this. So let me now summarize the thing. So I don't need this. Let me put this up. So something very simple happens in linearized gravity, which does not happen at all in nonlinear gravity, but we will still use part of the thing. So in linearized gravity, here's the thing, it's here, yes. In linearized gravity, there were three types of multiple moments, in the sense that we said H bar mu nu, the gravitational waves, this was a formula written somewhere here, is expressed in terms of source multiple moments. So it is a functional of two sets of multiple moments where I just sketch is an integral over the source, okay, of the mass density XL with some decoration and thing like that. So this was something I compute from the source. Like if I have a binary system, I take the quadrupole moment of the mass of the neutron star, the mass of the neutron star, okay, from the source. And this expressed the wave in multiple decomposition. But now I had also the wave at infinity. I transform to a TT gauge. I have the wave that LIGO is detecting. This wave was expressed in terms of radiative multiple moments, so HTT, which is computed from this, so it's not used, is expressed in two multiple moments. But even if I am in a nonlinear theory, I can define now UL and VL, not because the formulas will not be all correct. So I can say, if I am in a nonlinear gravity, I take the wave at infinity. It has this form, okay? It's just a parametrization of the wave. I decompose it in multiples. And therefore, it has some radiative multiple moments. Now, in linearized gravity, we had found, for the linearized case, UL is simply the time derivative, half time derivative of IL, and VL is simply the half time derivative of JL. So this is a relation which is valid only in linearized gravity, and it will be modified, okay? Yes, so I had those three things. I can integrate this over the source. I can parameterize the solution outside the source in terms of these multiple moments. And then I have radiative multiple moments, which are time derivative of this. So I know everything. Now, what happens in the nonlinear case is much more intricate, but one can use still things. So I will sketch the technique we use. So this is what we call the MPM multipolar post-Minkowskian. So now, multipolar post-Minkowskian, by the way. And Minkowskian means not post-Newtonian. You know, we are going to do an expansion which will use, and this the idea of this expansion was first proposed by Bill Bonner, okay, in a restricted setting, and Kip Thorne emphasized maybe its usefulness, and then we have taken up the thing and pushed it in a, as a tool for computing things in a nonlinear way. So what do you do? You are going, you have a source which, for instance, is made of two, now it's a space-time picture. So the source I'm really interested in is the motion of two black holes or two neutron stars in space-time. So they make like this DNA thing, okay, they move in space-time. And you want very far from this, so 1 billion light years away, here, you want to know in this direction what is the HTTIJ wave that you get here, okay? The way you do it is you can still use these formulas in the sense that if you imagine that I take a big sphere 1 billion light years around the source, which is maybe a bit difficult, but you decompose in this symmetric trace free tensor and you just parameterize the wave here by this sum. Okay, it's just a parametrization. But now you want to know what is the relation. So you have this UL and VL. These are radiative moments at infinity that you can observe. And to answer the question of Natalie, they are all gauge invariant, this thing. I have fixed things, so that is gauge invariant. And these are like the 2 degrees of freedom of the wave, but in a multipolar sense. Now you want to know, how can I compute now this in terms of the source, knowing that I am not in linearized gravity. I need to take nonlinear effects, many nonlinear effects in gravity. So how do you do things? You do things in successive approximation. First, you are going to decompose you decompose the space-time in various zones, okay, around the source. And then you are going to use different approximation methods in each zone. There is a zone, the big approximation method, I mean the one with a big domain of validity will be this multipolar post-Minkowskian or Blanchet-Damour higher approximation method. Which will be in a big zone which goes essentially to infinity, and the reason why it does not go fully to infinity is that there are some logarithmic terms and you want to modify the, because you work in an harmonic gauge, yes. This will be done in an harmonic gauge. Now the harmonic gauge is bad when you go in a radiative zone very far because there are logarithmic terms that pop up, and but these logarithmic terms, they are not very difficult to handle, and there is a paper of 1987 by Luc Blanchet to show how to deal, to introduce a Bondi Sachs type coordinate system so that you have a good expansion in powers. So you need, here you will have some coordinates, TR theta phi. In this region, you will need to change the coordinate R to another coordinate to absorb some logarithmic things, okay, and to have a good expansion of the Bondi-Sachs type, okay. But so it is part of the scheme. But most of the calculations, they will be done here and here. In the zone near the source, you will use post-Newtonian theory, but later, okay, because this is a convenient way to compute the field generated near the source. Okay. The main, the meaty thing in the MPM is what happens in this thing. And the way, so the scheme is the following. What you do in this exterior zone, so this is, let's say, exterior zone. First, you are outside the source. So you solve Einstein equations in vacuum. So you solve R mu nu equals zero. Ricci flat. But how do you do it? You do it by a post-Minkowskian expansion, which means, in general, it's good to work now with the what was called in the old days the Gothic metric, which means, you know, square root of g mu nu inverse, okay? And you write the Gothic metric as eta mu nu, let me... Yes, so there is, if I want to keep the same, if I was writing here this way, I think if I put the a minus h bar. This h bar in linearized theory is the same as the h bar before, because the perturbation away from the Minkowski metric for the Gothic metric is actually the h mu nu minus 1 half h d mu. Actually, in the calculations, you don't put a minus sign here, you put it somewhere else. Okay, let's not worry about just a sign. And you solve Ricci equals 0 in terms of this. The advantage is that when you are in harmonic gauge, this object, so let me now forget about signs and notation. So I put plus h mu nu, but h mu nu is not a metric perturbation. It is this thing. Or if you want, you can put like a Gothic h mu nu. Okay? Now, the harmonic condition says, let's put a Gothic h mu nu, that this is 0 exactly. So the gauge condition is exactly that the divergence of this thing is 0, because the divergence of eta mu nu is equal to 0. And now when you write Einstein equations, you will, so when you write r mu nu equals 0, you will have equations that you can write formally as d'Alembert of this h mu nu, okay, is a sum of terms which contain two derivatives, and then I have terms quadratic in h, two derivatives, I have terms cubic in h, and then two derivatives, and then quartic in h, okay? I want just write Einstein equations formally like expanded around flat space, okay? We know it's not going to be always very good, but each time there will be a problem, we will locate it and then take into account the physics of what happens. Because this d'Alembert is a flat space-time d'Alembert. This way, you can solve really explicitly. That's why it's called post-Minkowskian, okay? Now, why is it called multipolar post-Minkowskian? Because at each level, so you are going to solve h mu nu as a successive thing, saying it's g h1 mu nu plus second order in g h2 mu nu plus third order h cube mu nu, etc. You push the calculation up to the needle. Where what? H1 mu nu will be the general solution of d'Alembert of H1 mu nu equals 0. But this means H1 mu nu is like a linearized gravity wave outside the source. We want to get the field which is obtained using boundary conditions of no incoming radiation. So we look for a general solution of Einstein equation outside the source, which is retarded type waves. But we have solved this problem. It is given by this, okay? There is the general formula for a general h mu nu, except that as we are nonlinear, we need to write that h1 mu nu is, so let's call this thing, this formula, the canonical solution of Einstein's linearized gravity expressed in terms of two sets of multiple moments, except that the multiple moments that we are going to put here are not related to the source, because we don't know now. We are somewhere here. We are just parametrizing a thing. So the two sets of multiple moments, so h canonical mu nu, we call them to distinguish them, ML and SL, but just to remember that M is mass type and S is spin type, okay, like this. And you need to take into account a gauge transformation, because the general solution is in a general gauge, and before changing gauge, it can be, you need actually to take into account later some changes of gauge. So you need to put back the various, now I forgot how many there are. There are some gauge multiple moments, okay? The ones I said we can eliminate, okay? There is W, yes. Okay. There are four, that's what I said before. There are four coordinate transformations you can make, so there are four multiple gauge transformations which are there. You put them, but they play a minor role, but it's important for the scheme to keep them. And now you iterate Einstein equations explicitly. And the power of this method is because you will be able to solve Einstein equations explicitly, because you combine post-Minkowskian expansion. Post-Minkowskian just means this, so you have done nothing at this stage. But you inject an explicit multipolar expansion for the solution. And now you look at the solution, so let me write here, at the solution for the second order, let's say. You have this thing, and in the right-hand side, what do you have? You have two derivatives, and you have something quadratic in H1. But H1 is the sum of function of t minus r over r with some space derivative. Each one is of this type. You take this, you add more derivative. Okay, if it is a time derivative, puts a dot here. If it is a space derivative, it augments the number of n, so it has still the same structure. But it is nonlinear. So to compute explicitly this nonlinear thing, one way is to expand everything, because as we explained before, this thing is like 1 over r f with the l derivatives, plus 1 over r square n some unit vector f with l minus 1 derivatives and things like that. It is, at the end, what you get is something fully explicit. And you need to do, I mean, it's not that you argue it will be of this type, you compute things. This thing is finally, will contain powers of 1 over r, in general, of the 1 over r type. They will be function of t minus r, because you have products of function of t minus r, and then there will be indices, okay? So depending on this, you will have new indices also floating around, and then, okay. After doing this thing, here, yes, this, sorry, let me, this function of t minus r is the product, so here it is the product, for instance, of ml with some derivatives, t minus r, times a different set, ml2, the t minus r with a certain number derivative, with some contraction of indices. So now, these were irreducible representation of the rotation group, but now you make the products of two irreducible representation, like dl1 times dl2, okay, depending on that. And then you need to redecompose it in irreducible parts, okay, to have something simple. Actually, what is most important is that the angular part, you can always, when you have angular parts, you can redecompose it in n hat l, because there is just a formula. For instance, if I have ni nj, I can say this is n hat ij, which is symmetric trace free, plus one third of delta ij. So, okay, I just use this to all orders. So, at the second level, therefore, you need to solve things like that. Okay. But now the difficulty is the following. This is a function of t minus r, so it is a kind of wave which goes like that, and it contains inverse powers of 1 over r. But it contains very high inverse powers of 1 over r, because if you think just of the quadrupole, for instance, the quadrupole contain 1 over r cube ij, for instance, of t minus r. If you take a time derivative and you take the square, you will have 1 over r6 of things like that. And then higher multiples, they go like 1 over r6. And what do you want? You want to solve this equation. Now, if you try to solve this equation in the form of retarded waves, you say, I compute the Green function, which is the Green function acting on the source. But what is this source? This source is something which has an angular dependence, but it has a radial dependence, okay? And the radial dependence is divergent when you go formally to r equals 0, which is okay, because I am outside the source, so I should not go inside r equals 0. I should solve this problem keeping outside the source. But the power of the method is that you don't do that. You formally now forget about the source. You say, let's, because the idea is the following. I have replaced the source, which is physically there, by a fictitious world line which has delta function singularities and derivative of delta function singularities in the sense that this thing is emitting multiples. So a multiple thing, you know, if I take D'Alembert of dl of f t minus r over r, D'Alembert of f t minus r over r is minus 4 pi f of t delta 3x. It's a delta function at the origin. Okay? It's a distribution theory formula, if I'm in distribution theory. Therefore, when I take L derivative, I will have L special derivative of the delta function. So it means the multiple decomposition means I have replaced the physical source, which was regular, which existed, by a formal set of derivative, a skeleton of derivative of delta function, something very singular. When I compute the products of the singular things that increase towards go to infinity, I get an integral which is infinite. Okay, so all these integrals are infinite, meaningless. But this is where you start doing some technological thing, which was inherited by what we had been doing before for the 2PN problem, is you use analytic continuation. You say, ah yes, Adamard does not work here, so it is more Schwartz-like or Gelfand type analytic continuation. You say, let me introduce a power of R, because this thing diverges. Because at the origin, yeah, by the way, is it clear for this green function? What is this green function? The green function that one is using, which is this thing, the retarded, this thing is a convolution operator with, it is a green function between the field point, Tx, and the source point, let's say T prime, X prime, okay? And this thing is what I had written before. It is delta of t minus t prime minus x prime over c divided by x minus x prime. Okay. So, and you integrate over x prime. So you have a Poisson integral, like 1 over x minus x prime. And if you multiply this by something which goes like 1 over r prime to something 3 or more, it diverges because the integral at r prime equals 0 becomes integral of d3 x prime over r prime 3 plus something. And this thing does not exist. It's a divergent integral. So what you do is, but you are not interested in this integral. You are interested in solving this equation, which is a different problem. So you have the right to do whatever you want so that at the end you get a solution. And what you do is you put here a factor which is r to the r 0 to the power b, where b is a complex number that you are going to choose. And if the real part of B is large enough, this says that the integral now becomes convergent. Because you see, if I have an integral, let me give an example. If I have d3x over r prime cube, okay, I go to polar coordinates. This means I have, let's put r to the power n. And let me change x prime to x. This thing is r squared dr d omega, the angles, divided by r to the n. Okay, so I have an integral over the angles, and then I have integral of dr over r to the n minus 2. Okay, if n is equal to 3 or larger, this is logarithmically divergent or worse. But if I multiply this by r over r0 to the power b, this becomes a convergent integral at r equals 0 if the real part of b is large enough. And therefore, I can compute this thing as a function of the parameter b. Now, you prove that this integral is a meromorphic, so it exists in the b plane, so in the plane of the variable b, which is a complex variable. You go sufficiently far on the right so that you can compute the integral here. And then now you ask, is this an analytic function of b? The answer is yes, because it's trivial to look at it. And the only singularities will be poles. So actually, by analytic continuation, it will define a meromorphic function of B. But at the end of the day, what you want is to go back to B equals 0, because this way you will have a solution of the problem you wanted. If you stay away from B equals 0, you don't have a solution of the problem. And but the worst that can happen, when you continue B up to B equals 0, is that the worst that can happen is you can have poles at B equals 0. But it's clear, when you look at it, you find immediately that the residue of the pole, the singular part will be, actually, at the first order, you get only simple poles, 1 over B, okay? They are not always poles, but if there is a pole, it will be 1 over b. And the coefficient of 1 over b, immediately you prove, is an homogeneous solution of the problem, okay? So you can subtract it, And you, if you subtract the singular part, you have what is called the finite part. So now you add, it's a finite part, but not in the sense of Adama of the finite part, because now this is valid. You put a finite part for B equals zero, which when you take the Laurent expansion, so this thing is a function of B, which has, you know, a coefficient like B to the k, plus a coefficient B to the k minus 1, plus C1 over B, and then there is C0, and then the parts of order B, okay? The finite part is this. You just subtract everything which is a pole or multipole, and then what you prove is that C0 is a solution of the problem you wanted. So it's just a mathematical trick, and the reason why it is useful is that you can compute all these integrals explicitly. And therefore, this way, given any at any order of nonlinearity, you have integrals which you can compute. You have products of STF tensors, you have function of R, because the reason why things simplify a lot is that all those things are just function of T minus R, and then there is a power of R, and then there are angular dependence. It's not like a complicated function that you don't know. It is something polynomial, essentially, modulo some function of T minus R. And with Luc, we could develop explicit formulas for computing this thing at the nonlinear level, okay? So, which means that given any order, you can, if you want, compute things. You need somebody very energetic, like Luc, to pursue this to high orders. And thanks to this work and energy, one got results at the nonlinear levels, okay? And now, but the logical point is the following. So I start from this, I give unknown seed multiple moments. So at the level H1, you put some unknown multiple moments, okay? Then you compute the solution at the next order, which is a function only of these multiple moments, okay? But now with nonlinear term. And then you can continue. So this way, okay, but at this stage, you have now to worry, we should be in harmonic gauge. So we have to check, is the harmonic gauge condition satisfied after the finite part? It is modulo something where you can correct, so you can generate, with some tweeting, something which is, at each level, a solution of the harmonic gauge condition and a solution of Einstein equations, therefore, at each stage, so you do that. So this way, you generate an H at any multiple order, because formally you can continue this to, evidently it gets very, very complicated, so you push things only to some level, but which is a function of unknown multiple moments. And the next step is to say, ah, but how do I determine these multiple moments? Because now I have computed the exterior. So one computes the exterior metric here, outside the source, as a formal functional. Also, when you do that, you never do a post-Newtonian expansion, because a post-Newtonian expansion is valid only in the near zone. Why it is crucial here to have something which is valid in the wave zone also. You want the validity of this expansion to go from outside the source up to infinity, essentially, modulo these logarithmic terms that you deal with separately. And the next step is to say, how do I now compute the value of these things, especially these two moments, in terms of the source variables?
Before you go there,
yes.
Can I ask a question? Because you have this all these multiples, and S, which are for the moment arbitrary.
They are arbitrary. They parameterize the solution.
Then when you regularize, you insisted on this 1 over R powers. But all that is multiplied by this F. FL,
yes.
FML. And for the moment, you have no idea of the dependence in T minus R of these things, because you have not related them yet to the source. So don't you have to make assumptions about
no.
the behavior?
It, you compute things. What do you mean, the behavior? They, if
the how they diverge at the origin or something. These FLs, the coefficients of the 1 over R term.
What you have to prove is you have to prove that to all orders, because what happens is that when you go to, for instance, if you keep the number of multiples fixed, you say I go up from L equal 0 to L equal L max, to make things clear. When you do that, the order of divergence at the origin will increase at each order of the post-Minkowskian approximation, okay? And to be able to prove that there was an analytic continuum, and then logarithms pop up. And you have to prove analytic continuation in presence of logarithms. So we introduce with Luc spaces that we called LNs, which had a special signification for me. But anyway, that was just a name, which contain a logarithm up to powers nth of the logarithm. And you prove that ln goes to ln plus 1. And then you can do, we prove to all orders in expansion in G that you can always do the analytic continuation. And you can always solve the problem formally. Okay. So it generates a solution at the end of the Einstein equation. We are not saying it's the, it generates the general solution in the sense that this solution contains the number of arbitrary multiple moments that exist in a, that you expect to exist in a physical solution. So, but at this stage, you construct a solution. And the next step is to relate it to the source. And the way you do it is you solve now a different problem, is that you solve a post-Newtonian problem. Now you reintroduce the source, so you say, ah, but here I have matter, okay, which moves around. And now I am going to solve Einstein equations by a different perturbation scheme, which is a post-Newtonian scheme. So a post-Newtonian scheme, instead of using D'Alembert thing, you write D'Alembert as delta minus 1 over c squared, d squared over dt squared, and you treat this as a small term that you put on the right-hand side, and you solve Poisson-type equations. The problem of the post-Newtonian scheme is very good for computing explicitly things up to some order, but it gets bad when you go in the wave zone. That is to say, it has a domain of validity, formal domain of validity, which is limited to be at a distance from the source r much smaller than the wavelength emitted by the system. Okay. But the exterior computation is valid in a zone which formally is at any radius which is larger than not something linked to the wavelength, because you made no near zone approximation here. You are post-Minkowskian. So the only thing is that you should be much larger than the size of the source. Let's call it S, okay? And if now the size of the source is much smaller than the wavelength emitted by the source, but precisely this is the post-Newtonian approximation saying the velocities are smaller than unity and much smaller than unity, you have an intermediate zone between two shells, two tubes. You know, you have a tube here and another tube. And in this tube, the two formal, so these are all formal power series, I mean formal expansions. The outside expansion is an expansion in powers of g, and the inside expansion, or g over c squared, is an expansion in powers of 1 over c squared. And then you use the method of match asymptotic expansion, which is to say, in an intermediate zone, the two expansions should be expansion of the same object, the same metric, modulo a gauge transformation, because we don't know if the harmonic gauge we use outside is the same harmonic gauge we use inside. That's why you need to put a general gauge, because otherwise, there would be a mismatch even within the realm of harmonic gauges. And this information you can transmute in explicit computation to compute this thing as a function of the source, because the post-Newtonian approximation computes everything in terms of the source. Here, you compute everything in terms of these objects which are unknown. By saying that the two things are the same, you compute these things in terms of the source. Let me, to end, illustrate this at the first non-trivial thing, which is the 1PN approximation.
Thibault, can I ask a question?
Yes.
Quick one. So in the case of electrodynamics, you could do the same thing, but in this case, you know,
it's a linear theory, so it's...
It's linear, so it's much easier.
Yeah, electromagnetism, the answer was exact there, so I did not need to... It's because I have all the non-linearities of Einstein equations. So in terms of diagram, this is saying the source emits something, which is then combining with something else from the source. And then I have cubic vertices. So I need to take the interaction of two multiples from the source that generate something outside. and I have many renormalization of the of things to take into account. First, I should say before because the first thing we did with Luc was the first one post-Newtonian approximation, and there was something remarkably simple happening, okay, which does not happen to higher orders. Luc later, when one had to compute the 2PN approximation, found a nice trick, which is the following. Yes, let me write maybe the final type of formulas. Yes, we'll see. So here you need to dirty your hands, okay? The final formulas is you want to compute the multipoles, so let's call these the radiative multipoles. Okay, this is really what it's the wave at infinity. Okay, it parameterizes what you see in a detector at infinity. But the problem is when I am not in linearized gravity, I could relate this to the time derivative of IL, and IL was an integral over the source, so everything was solved. Now I will have more nonlinear terms. I am looking for a relation where UL is related to some integral over the source, but which takes into account nonlinear effects in a systematic way. And the MPM method gives this. And let me show the type of formulas you get, because you need to distinguish two types of nonlinearities that come in. But let me write the type of formula you get. You get that the thing you are interested in, which are the multiple moments at infinity. So there is a UL and a VL. Let me write first the UL. Is equal to, so there are several multiple moments in the game. For the moment, I have said there is these moments that can be called the algorithmic multiple moments that you introduce in the solution before you relate them to the source. Then they disappear. After a while, these moments are replaced by something in terms of the source. And let me write the formula at this stage. You find that the UL is given by a formula which looks like the one before, in the sense that this is the Elf time derivative of something that will be expressed in terms of the source, but I still have to write it down. But I have extra corrections which come from something which Yvonne knows very well, which is the fact that when you are in curved space-time, the Green function does not propagate along the light cone, but it has a tail, that the Green function has a part inside the light cone. And these things, when you compute them explicitly, means that what you observe at infinity will not be only a function of the source at the retarded time, like going straight to the source to the velocity of light, but will contain an integral over the infinite past. That is to say, what the source did a billion years before we saw it, so before the light came already a billion years after that, let's say 10 billion years before, still influences the gravitational wave at infinity. So these are the so-called hereditary effects, as we call them with Luc. So you have integrals over the past. And this can be computed explicitly. The first, at lowest order, you get this integral, 0 to plus infinity, d tau, of the same object. So remember, L means L indices, OK? L plus two derivatives, OK? At a time U, the same, U is a retarded time, okay? It's, actually, I should have kept the thing that it's not small u, it's capital U. The reason why it is capital U is that this U is not, is like T minus R minus 2G, the total mass over C squared log of R. Like, you know, in the correction, there is a logarithmic correction. The retarded time, you have to take into account the fact that the light cones are not flat. They are bent by logarithmic terms, by the total mass of the system and other things. So you have this type of logarithmic corrections that you normalize this way. But this is still, in a sense, the real retard, I mean, it's the retarded time, okay, in a curved space-time. But you depend on this something before with a logarithmic kernel. Log, ln means Napier log, natural log. Okay, C tau over 2 R0 plus a numerical coefficient, don't worry, and VL of U is given by the same type of formula, except it is the other multiple moments, GL L of U, plus the same coefficient 2, GM over C cube. And this M actually should be the it's the ADM mass of the system, okay? 0 to plus infinity, total energy of the system, of JL L plus 2 times U minus tau, log of C tau over 2 R0. R0 is the scale. To do these computations, you needed to regularize divergent integrals, and there are logarithms coming in. So you need to introduce a scale, R0. This scale does not enter in physical effects. You prove at the end that the scale is arbitrary, okay? But there is, so here tau is a time, C tau is a length. You divide by a length, it is a dimensionless thing in the log. And then there is a different numerical constant here, pi L, and there are extra terms. This is the first tail effects. Luc has studied the tails of the tails, the nonlinear tails. There are terms beyond that you can compute. But here I've introduced IL and JL. What are these? These objects are obtained by the finite part with respect to... So to compute these, you need again to introduce a finite part and an analytic continuation with a factor r over r0 to the power b, okay? But it has a different meaning now because the finite part you needed here was because of an UV divergence, that is to say a divergence at the origin, okay? While here you will have an infrared divergence, which is a divergence at large spatial distances, but it's just the same thing that you see in a different way, because once you are inside the source, you have divergences there. Outside, you see them differently. Anyway, the formalism tells you you have this. And this thing, the nice thing is that here you put the IL as computed in linearized theory, that is to say, these formulas and the other formulas that my assistant has erased. And but remember, this is an explicit integral, okay, in terms of these integrals were integrals over T mu nu of the source. This was in linearized gravity. So these things were integral of something with some kernels T mu nu. What you do is you take the same functionals, but you replace T mu nu by tau mu nu. And you have the same formula. So you use the formulas of linearized gravity. That's why I said the formulas of linearized gravity are useful, because JL linearized, T mu nu goes to tau bar mu nu, where tau mu nu is the right-hand side of Einstein equations when you write it in the form tau mu nu equal. So now I'm not sure of the sign, but there is. It's like what I was for each mu nu, you have finally something like minus or plus, I'm not sure, of 16 pi over C4 times T mu nu. When you write Einstein equations, you have this plus all the nonlinear terms that you can put here. These are nonlinear terms, and you call the sum of the T mu nu. There is the G also. There is the determinant which appears here. Okay. So everything here, the determinant G, T mu nu, plus the nonlinear terms in Einstein equations, which are dH, dH, plus H, all the terms, you give it a name. You say, okay, it's the right answer of Einstein equations. I call it tau mu nu, okay? But the nice thing is that formally replacing in these formulas T mu nu by tau mu nu gives this part of the multiple moments to which you must still add another nonlinear term, which is the hereditary tail terms. But at the end, this you can compute because you compute it. Now this integral is dominated by what happens in the source, but it extends outside the source. But the finite part with the r over r0 to the b allows you to define the thing uniquely. And this gives the good answer that you can compute to any order you want in post-Newtonian theory now. So this scheme, which has used post-Minkowskian and post-Newtonian, at the end gives something practical, something which is not easy when you go beyond the leading order, but which has been pushed to quite high orders, and which is the basis of what will be used to compute the radiation of binary black holes up to merger, because you will use this post-Newtonian. These post-Newtonian things allows you to compute the waveform. So the waveforms here would be this HLM, which was somewhere. Now it disappeared. It's up there, HLM. Yes, it is there, okay? So you want to compute the multiple things emitted really by a binary black hole, okay? And what you do, you have this scheme, which you combines post-Minkowskian and post-Newtonian thing, but which allows to compute the waveform as an expansion in powers of V over C. This expansion will lose its validity when you go near merger, and we will discuss another method, which is the resummation methods, which are used in the effective one-body formalism, to go up to merger, starting from things which should not be allowed to be pushed up to merger. Did I want to say something else, or just to actually, we can probably stop here. Everybody must be tired. Yes, I won't. Ah, yes, let me just mention one thing, that if you do this at the 1PN approximation, because this is something at least very simple in this scheme, if you do this at the 1PN approximation that we had done with Luc before Luc found this formula, you find, and this is remarkable, that the formulas of linearized gravity, if you write them in terms of the contravariant components of T, which is not the same as writing them in terms of the covariant, because I'm now in nonlinear theory, are exact. That is to say, that they give the correct 1PN mass type multiple moment emitted by the source. So to compute the emission of a binary system from the mass type multiple moments at the first post-Newtonian approximation, which means going beyond Einstein, the remarkable thing is that they are given by the same formulas as linearized gravity. Okay, it's an accident. At the 2PN order, there are nonlinear terms that are more complicated to compute that you need to tackle with. Okay.
So does that mean that there are no lambda Lifshitz term?
Good question. Actually, what it means is that when you compute the sigma, which was like, so when you compute, let me write this because I noted it. So the technical thing is that, yes, I have written it here. It is because this thing, which is the, so it's the sum of this and all the nonlinear terms at the 1PN, happens to be the thing with the contravariant components like that. There is an extra term, because still there are nonlinearities, like the determinant here, it's not the same. But the extra term is 1 over 2 pi g, Laplace of the square of the Newtonian potential, where d'Alembert of V is minus 4 pi times g sigma. So it's a relativistic, but it is, it's a Laplace of a thing. And when you replace the Laplace here, you find it does not contribute by integrating by parts. Because you compute, when you compute the quadrupole moment, you in, or anything, because the Laplace goes on xi, xj and gives zero because it is a harmonic function. So at the 1PN, there is something nice. Okay, the nonlinearities are like non-existent. But at the second post-Newtonian and third post-Newtonian, you need to use complicated calculations. You need to use dimensional regularization. But that will be discussed next time. Okay, thank you.